Yes, what about the distribution and the exhibit in Chile of your films? Do you have support from the government to do that since you're having so many more films now?
Yeah, we have some support. The exhibition situation is pretty fucked up. And right now we don't really have like an alternative system that is working, and the multiplexes, you know, it's the same everywhere. When they arrived, it was like, well, there's so many screens, so there's going to be space for everything. And now what you find is that when one big film comes out, it has like 7 screens in a 10 screen multiplex, which is like ridiculous. So often it's the case that those films have a really hard time to find screens. I hope this is in a way going to start changing, and there's some indication that this might be the case. But you know, right now it's a bit of a, you know, what Jonathan Rosenbaum called movie wars. I don't know if you heard of that book. That's exactly what we're at now in Chile. And we're still losing, but we're fighting.
I'm sorry, one more thing. And what about the people from Chile? Do they like Chilean movies? Have you already won that audience? How do they receive your movies?
Well, there is naturally a group of directors who are making more commercial stuff, and they are getting more people into their films. That scene, the more industrial approach to cinema, is in a way more, it's more at the beginning of their process than the films that are closer to what I'm doing. But as I said, like, it's hard to say because there are so many different things going on at the same time. But there really is a thing that we have to focus on right then, because it really, the exhibition situation leaves us with very little space often. And so I don't know, like my previous film made more people in Lithuania than in Chile, which is absurd. It's not that, and I know that it does not mean that I had a bigger market potential in Lithuania, but there was just people there who were not trying to kick me out of the screens, yeah, which was the case in Chile. And, yeah.
Thank you.
The story is based on a Chilean novel, and why did you choose this story in particular to make a film out of?
I thought it was a great novel to start with, which does not necessarily mean that it was good material for a film. It was not evident that it was good material for a film at first. And at some point I read it again, and there is something generational which I thought was interesting. This book came out in 2006, which is pretty contemporary book. The author is exactly the same age as I. And yeah, I think there is something that is maybe not explicitly said that relates to a certain experience that I think is particular of our generation. We're pretty much the first generation that got into adulthood after the dictatorship. And that means basically without that huge collective reference that was maybe oppressive but gave certainties. And yeah, and on the other hand, I really like the fact that the bonsai aspect was not just tackled by the story in the book, but also in the style, the structure, and even the design of the book as an object. And I think that's pretty much an approach with which I feel identified when I'm thinking of filmmaking. And yeah, at first you didn't want to give me the rights, but then yeah, I persuaded him.
Did he like the film?
Yeah, he liked it a lot. I mean, I was showing him the script, but then when I shot, I stopped showing him anything, and then he went to Cannes and he was part of the whole thing. He liked it.
Another thing that just captured me since the beginning that I saw the film was all the actors, and I was telling you earlier that, especially from, because I'm a fan of a Chilean theater company called Teatro Blanco. How did you cast all the actors? I think they're perfect in their roles.
Yeah, we did a lot of auditions, especially for the three young ones. We did like a lot of rounds, like more than 10, I think. And I tried a lot of combinations, like if until like, can I go to this balance when I like how they look together and also how they were playing together and they could understand this tone. There is not, you know, it's like a deadpan tone, but not too extreme, but it's not natural. And yeah, basically all the four main actors, they all had to go through auditions. They were pretty, you know, took us a long time to make a decision. So by the time we were preparing the shoot, we didn't need to rehearse because they already rehearsed enough.
And they had to look also really young and
yeah, that was another thing because like we're not going to have a huge budget, and I didn't use makeup at all, so it was not. There are people who somehow have even a child in them. You can look at them and you can kind of imagine how they were as children. Some people you just don't. And I think Diego had this sort of quality where you could not do a huge intervention on him, but you could kind of see in him someone a little younger, someone a little older. Because it's not a huge difference, 8 years, it's not 20 years, you know. But yeah, he worked very hard between those two shoots to get ready.
I wanted to also point out the music. We really, and the programming team, we really, really like the music. And so did you use local bands and also like music from before and now, and how did you choose all the music for the film?
Music is always something that I consider really can be a huge contribution, but it's hard to choose, at least for me. With my previous film, I always had a hard time with music. So I wrote a lot of music into the screenplay that was, you know, diegetical music, so music from the scene where the characters are listening to something or dancing to something. So my first approach was just to have that sort of music, not have any incidentals at all. But then when I shot the first cut to Panico, which is the band that plays when they're in college, they told me, you know, I think we would like to give it a go and suggesting something. And I said, yeah, okay, let's have a look. And they made all these little pieces that are, in a way, inspired by nature, the rain, the wind, and I think it kind of adds a layer that was good. So yeah, I decided to stick to it, and it's still there in the film.
Does anybody have a question? Oh, okay.
First of all, great film. Second, love your accent. And lastly, what was your budget? If you're able to reveal that.
I don't know if I'm able to reveal it.
Can you give us a range?
Low.
Under 100,000?
No. No. Actually, when the film got into Cannes, my producer said that we should not say the budget. Because it's kind of low, but it's not like we're not like those films that in a way exploit how low budget they are. We are like in a sort of half budget, but it's low, below 1 million, which is even for Chile not so much.
Well, it's a great film.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The Proust is already in the novel Bonsai, and. You know, the Bonsai is a really short book. You can read it in 45 minutes. So it's like an anti-Proust, because it has this sort of Proustian approach, but it's a bit of a joke on Proust at the same time, which is what I also try to make with the film.
Yeah.
I'm spending a lot of time in France lately, and almost half of the people I talk to, they are obsessed with Proust. And
my favorite author.
Yeah, like it looks like every single journalist I talk to wrote their dissertation on Proust, and they want to have this sort of spirited debate about Proust and my film. And I'm not really a Proust expert. I read them, I didn't finish them, you know. And I didn't read the last one, because everyone was saying to me, you have to read the first one and the last one. And what's in the middle, you just browse it, you know. But I did the three first ones, and that was like a long time ago. I have an idea of what Proust means, and I know that there are some connections, but just like the novel, there's also some sort of joking about the seriousness with which Proust is usually considered and appreciated. We are trying not to take ourselves so seriously. The novel is not a very psychological novel or very concrete. It's very short, and it's like a whole life in a few pages, and not just Julius, but many other characters. So the first huge decision I made was to center all around Julio as a main character, with whom we are kind of, you know, traveling through his life. And I also decided to work with these two time periods that, in a way, are playing one at once against the other of contrast. No. And so once I did that, in a way, I went to a sort of bare minimum, and then I expanded. I added some characters that were not there, and I made it in a way more personal. Like, in the film, they go to university in the south, in Valdivia, which is my hometown, which was not the case in the book, where they were always in Santiago, in the capital. The grandmother in the film is my grandmother. She's not an actress. And she's basically playing herself. So that's, you know, probably as personal a contribution to the film it can get.
Cinema, and maybe it has to do with when we were talking about the post-dictatorship and how you guys are the first generation or adults that are coming out of that, and why there's an explosion of Chilean cinema. Like, right now we also have another film thing that AFI Chile,
and
we're seeing a lot more films coming out of your country, and I don't know if you have anything to say about that.
Yeah, there's a lot of people thinking about that right now in Chile. There's, for the first time, there's a book was released recently that tries to make sense of the new Chilean film scene. I don't know, I think it's a combination of elements. It's on the one hand, the fact that with digital cameras, a film can be made eventually for very little money. There is a little bit more money in Chile, plus the state has been giving subsidies, sometimes in a kind of random manner, but somehow that adds to something always. And yeah, I guess, up to the dictatorship and early, there was like a time where at first people were getting really more into, you know, the political role of what they were doing rather than maybe the language or their real artistic contribution. And then there was like a whole group of filmmakers that went from that to just trying to make money, which was pretty much the spirit of the country during the 90s. And it's something I tried to kind of capture in the film, this idea that everything had to be, you know, productive and pragmatic. And then from 2005 on, it was the moment where a new generation came with films that were just trying to be exploiting the expression possibilities of film, nothing else. And I think that really produced a huge impact in the whole scenes. And right now there's a lot of people making different kind of films. It's really hard even to define the groups of people. And it's like 15 films a year, whereas in 1998 it was one a year. So it really is a huge thing. Some people compare it with what was going on in Chile in the late 60s, what was called Nuevo Cine Chileno, New Chilean Cinema. But that group of people, they had really a common view of cinema, of the world. It was part of, you know, something bigger of what cinema was part. And I think what we have now is really just diverse. And yeah, it's really exciting to be part of it. And there's so many so young directors as well coming, like 21, 22, 23 year olds, already just doing features, and some of them are quite decent.
And no one else has
Would you, I loved your movie, by the way. Thank you so much for coming with it.
Thank you.
Would you cite any other filmmakers as your influences?
Yeah. There's always influences. And they happen in such weird ways. Sometimes you don't even think of it. Like when I was in Cannes, every French person I talked to wanted to talk about Romare, and I didn't think that I had anything to do with Romare, but at the same time, when I was thinking about it, I realized that when I was the age of these characters, which is a time I was really thinking about when I was doing all the writing, I was watching a lot of Romare. And, you know, sometimes things just pop in weird ways. There are many American directors I like because that's what we watch the most, like everywhere else. Classic stuff as well. I'm a big fan of Preston Sturges. And yeah, Woody Allen.
I knew it.
But yeah, and there's also an Asian connection with this film. And even though there's maybe less obvious for this film, but while I was preparing this film, I was developing the next one that really has like an Asian. It's a family film, so I was, you know, watching Ozu and all those early Taiwanese, you know, the new Taiwanese wave, you know, Edward Yang, early Ang Lee, and Hu Xiaoxian, and I don't know, maybe those things just go into the film somehow. I don't know.